ॐ भूर्भुवः स्वः तत्सवितुर्वरेण्यं भर्गो देवस्य धीमहि धियो यो न प्रचोदयात्।
Over the funeral pyres of the martyrs, every year people will gather, and this shall be the only memory left of those who have laid down their lives for the motherland. The above lines of the martyr poet Bismil are justified in word and spirit by this mile-long procession on the occasion of the anniversary of the martyrdom of Swami Shwadhananda. Our country has had a tradition of martyrs and great men who gave away everything, including their lives, for the country, but became marginalized in the history of the nation. One such great man was Swami Shwadhananda, who dedicated his entire life to the service of the nation and attained martyrdom.
दुनिया का कोई भी ऐसा आदमी हमें नजर नहीं आता जो उनका मुकाबला कर सके। जितनी उन्होंने कुर्बानी की है वो कोई भी नहीं कर सकता है।
मैं ये कहूँगा कि वो मनुजता का मान थे, शूरता की शान थे, गुणियों का गान थे, युग का अभिमान थे, ऋषियों और मुनियों की आन थे, जाति का स्वाभिमान थे।
He was born in this house in Talwan village of Jalandhar district of Punjab. He was named Brahaspati at birth, but later came to be called Munshi Ram. And after attaining sannyas, he became Swami Shradhanand.
ਇਹ ਜਗ੍ਹਾ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਪਰਿਵਾਰ ਦੀ ਆ, ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਘਰ ਦੀ ਆ, ਅਸਲ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦਾ ਰਹਿਸ਼ੀ ਘਰ ਇਹ ਸੀ। ਐਸੇ ਬੜੇ ਬਜ਼ੁਰਗ ਦੀ ਜਗ੍ਹਾ ਮੇਂ ਕੋਈ ਵੀ ਕੰਮ ਨਹੀਂ ਅੱਛਾ ਹੋ ਰਿਹਾ।
ਇਸ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਸੀਗਾ ਜੀ, ਪਤਾ ਨਹੀਂ ਬਾਕੀ ਇੰਨਾ ਪਤਾ ਹੀ, ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਕੁਰਬਾਨੀ ਬੜੀ ਸੀ। ਇੱਥੇ ਗਿਆਨੀ ਜੈਲ ਸਿੰਘ ਆਇਆ ਸੀ, ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀ ਜਗ੍ਹਾ ਬਣਾਉਣ ਵਾਸਤੇ ਵੀ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਅੰਗਰੇਜ਼ਾਂ ਦੇ ਟਾਈਮ ਦੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਬੜਾ ਮਤਲਬ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਕੰਮ ਕੀਤਾ, ਹਰੇਕ ਦਾ ਸਾਥ ਦਿੱਤਾ।
His father, Sri Nanak Chand, served in the British police in the United Provinces. Swamiji was born in a Kshatriya family.
Swami Shraddhanand ji ke natin hone ke nate main bahut garv mehsoos karti hoon aur main sochti hoon ki Parmatma ne ye shayad hame saubhagya diya hai ki hame itne acche sanskar mile hain unhe se।
ये तो मुझे याद है कि उनको देखकर हम लोग खुश बहुत होते थे। यू सी ही वॉज नॉट लाइक स्टिफ स्वामी, ही यूज टू कम एंड यू नो पुट हैंड लाइक दैट एंड से हाउ आर यू, व्हाट आर यू डूइंग लाइक दैट, जस्ट लाइक ए फ्रेंड।
मैं 8 साल की थी, अपने भाई के साथ मैं अब नौकर को लेकर के, और हमसे हमारे घर से थोड़ी दूर के पर था उनका जो रहने की जगह थी, तो वहाँ जाती थी और जाकर उनके पास बड़े प्यार से वो मिलते थे। बोलते थे आती रहा करो तुम, हाँ। और फिर वो बादाम बादाम कुछ बना के मेवा वेवा सा रखते थे, कुछ पूड़ियाँ ऐसी, तो हम लोग जाते थे उनके पास।
माँ जो थी वो हमारी बहुत प्रभावित थी अपने पिताजी से, क्योंकि वो अपनी माता जी को बहुत छोटी उम्र में खो चुकी थी, तो जो कुछ भी परवरिश की वो पिताजी ने की। बेशक उन्होंने संन्यास ले लिया था बहुत जल्दी, लेकिन फिर भी मेरी माता जी वेद कुमारी उनकी सबसे बड़ी पुत्री थी। उन्होंने किसी तरह से भी उनको महसूस नहीं होने दिया कि उनकी माँ नहीं।
मेरा ख्याल है मैं 7 या 8 साल की थी जब मैं आर्य समाज गई, तो पहली दफ़ा मुझे पता चला कि मैं स्वामी श्रद्धानंद की ग्रेट ग्रैंड डॉटर हूँ, और उनकी फ़ोटोग्राफ वहाँ देख के और मैं उनकी ग्रेट ग्रैंड डॉटर हूँ सोच के मुझे बहुत ही अभिमान हुआ कि मैं इनकी फैमिली की हूँ, इस ये हेरिटेज है मेरी।
I'm Swami Shradhanand ji's great great granddaughter, that is his granddaughter is my grandmother. I would like my daughter to grow up realizing that she's a great, 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 great grandchild of such a great man. And it's important to have roots like this.
Due to the frequent transfers of his father, Munshi Ram's early education was often disturbed. From childhood till youth, he spent a long time in Varanasi. He studied here in Revdi Talab School, Karan Ghanta School and Queen's College. He was also educated at Bareilly and Allahabad. In Allahabad, he was a classmate of Pandit Motilal Nehru. In this very city of Varanasi, he started losing his faith in God. Munshi Ram was a firm believer and he visited the Vishwanath temple every day. But one day when he reached the temple, a guard stopped him, saying that the queen of Rewa state was paying her obeisance and nobody can enter until she left. This event gave a severe jolt to Munshi Ram's faith and he decided never to believe in a god that discriminates. In this very city, Munshi Ram visited gambling dens, confronted unsavory elements, and thus swam and sank many times in the ocean of immorality. These very banks of the Ganges were frequented by Swamiji for his morning walks and bathing. He used to learn wrestling and other martial arts here. Here, he witnessed believers being exploited in every manner by holy frauds. Swamiji saved a girl from the clutches of a fake sadhu who was trying to outrage her modesty. Swamiji even tried to embrace other faiths, but he found that things were no different even there and he became a total non-believer. On 14th Shravan Samvat 1936, Maharshi Dayanand Saraswati visited Bareilly where Munshi Ram was then living with his father. As the chief of the city police, it became Nanak Chandji's responsibility to maintain peace during the Maharshi's speeches. Nanak Chand was greatly influenced by the Maharshi's thoughts, so he suggested to his son Munshi Ram that he should attend Maharshi's discourses. Munshi Ram did not have great respect for sadhus and swamis, but just to please his father, he went to attend one of Maharshi's lectures. The very first lecture of Maharshi influenced Munshi Ram deeply. As a result, he would be the first person to reach the venue of the discourse, the town hall of Bareilly. Maharshi's discourses went on for many days, and each day, Munshi Ram would come with the most difficult of questions. And Maharshi, within no time, would solve those questions and leave Munshi Ram speechless. Finally, Munshi Ram said to him, "Your Grace, although you have left me speechless, you could not make me believe in the existence of God." Hearing this, Maharshi smiled and then replied, "You asked me questions, I answered them. I never promised you that I shall make you believe in his existence. You will believe in God's existence only when he wills it." Even after coming in contact with Maharshi, Munshi Ram's wayward life continued as usual. His devoted wife, Shiv Devi Ji, played an important role in the transformation of Munshi Ram into Swami Shradanand. It was in Bareilly that Munshi Ram one night returned home very late. He was completely drunk. Staggering and vomiting, he collapsed straight onto his bed. His wife Shiv Devi Ji kept awake the whole night, resting his head on her lap. She did not even eat that night, as she always ate only after him. Later, she also offered all her ornaments to him to clear his debts. Munshi Ram was deeply moved by these gestures, and thus took his first step towards becoming Shradanand. In 1888, Munshi Ram, along with his family, came to live in Jalandhar, where he practiced as a lawyer. At the same time, he took active part in the Arya Samaj activities. In 1896, he gave up his law practice to dedicate himself fully to the cause of the Arya Samaj.
Swami Shradanand Ji ke is samaj ke bilkul samne rehte the. जब अपनी वो प्रैक्टिस करते थे यहाँ जलंधर में लाला देवराज जी जो जिन्होंने कन्या महाविद्यालय शुरू किया वो उनके साथी होते थे और इसी समाज के वो प्रधान भी थे.
He was the president of the Adda Hushyarpur Arya Samaj from where he initiated a number of social reform programs. He started the work of securing equal treatment for Dalits including opening schools for them. In Jalandhar, there lived the Rehtiyan community. They called themselves Hindus but were not accepted as such by the caste Hindus. Munshi Ramji moved a resolution in the Arya Samaj to accept them as equal, but the resolution fell through. Munshi Ramji initially faced some hesitation from both the Hindu society and from the Arya Samaj as well in accepting Dalits as equals. Swamiji worked tirelessly for the upliftment of the Dalits. Gandhiji wrote about Swamiji, "No other man in India has done for Dalits as much as what Swamiji has done."
डॉक्टर अंबेडकर ने लिखा है कि स्वामी श्रद्धानंद जी से बढ़कर दलितों का कोई भी हितैषी नहीं। स्वामी जी ने दलितों के लिए बुढ़ापे के अंदर हजारों मील की पैदल यात्रा करके वे दक्षिण भारत में गए और केरल में वाइकम के सत्याग्रह का उन्होंने नेतृत्व किया। वहाँ वाइकम में एक बहुत बड़ा मंदिर है जिसको मैंने देखा है, उसके चारों ओर सड़कों पर कोई भी दलित जो था वो जा नहीं सकता था, मुसलमान और ईसाई तो जा सकता था। स्वामी जी ने इस भेदभाव के विरुद्ध सत्याग्रह किया। केरल के मॉडर्न टाइम्स के जितने बड़े नेता थे, टॉप मोस्ट थे, मूर्धन्य थे, वह सब स्वामी जी के सत्याग्रही बने। केरल के अनक्राउन किंग मन्नत पद्मनाभन जो हैं, उन्होंने मुझे कहा था कि मुझे इस बात का अभिमान है कि मैं भगवान श्रद्धानंद का सैनिक हूँ। वाइकम सत्याग्रह में मैं सम्मिलित हुआ था। उन्होंने लाठियाँ खाईं, उनका बहिष्कार किया गया, सब प्रकार से विरोध किया गया, परंतु वे डगमगाए नहीं।
श्रद्धानंद जी इवड़े वह सत्याग्रह प्रवर्तीवर सत्याग्रह आवर्क अल प्रेरणको प्रसन्न अद तटसम പോലീസ് വരെ അതിനെതിരായിട്ട് അദ്ദേഹത്തിനെതിരായിട്ട് പ്രവർത്തിച്ചു, ദേഹോപദ്രവം ഏൽപ്പിച്ചു.
കോളിംഗ് മെമ്പേഴ്സ് ഓഫ് ദി സോ കോൾഡ് ലോ കാസ്റ്റ് അൺടച്ചബിൾ വാസ് അൺഅക്സെപ്റ്റബിൾ ടു സ്വാമിജി. ഹി ഫൗണ്ട് ഇറ്റ് ടു ഹ്യൂമിലിയേറ്റിംഗ്. സ്വാമിജി വാസ് ദി ഫസ്റ്റ് ടു അഡ്രസ് ദം ആസ് ദലിത്സ്, വിച്ച് റെപ്രസെന്റഡ് ദി ലോ സോഷ്യോ എക്കണോമിക്കൽ കണ്ടീഷൻ ബട്ട് നോട്ട് ദേർ ലോലിനെസ് ബൈ ബർത്ത്. Swamiji was also instrumental in setting up the central body of the Arya Samaj, the Sarvadeshik Arya Pratinidhi Sabha. These are the remains of the one-time palatial residence of Advocate Munshi Ram, who lived here with his family. Unfortunately, his wife Shiv Devi died very early. She left a note for Swamiji that said, "You will get an even more beautiful and understanding partner than me, but kindly do not overlook my children." And Swamiji never remarried. He practiced what he preached. He started social reforms from his own household. His wife did not have to practice parda. He propagated women's education by teaching his wife personally. He didn't get any of his children married before they attained marriageable age.
उन्होंने अपने बच्चों की शादी, अपनी बेटी की शादी भी जन्मना जातिवाद को तोड़कर की डॉक्टर सुखदेव जी के साथ।
उन्होंने अपने सबसे बड़े बेटे की शादी जो है वो एक विधवा चुन के, वो टीचर थी कहीं पर, वो चुन के लाए और उसके साथ शादी।
स्वामी जी लव्ड चिल्ड्रन। ही प्लेड क्रिकेट विद देम इन द कंपाउंड ऑफ हिज हाउस एंड इन द श्रावण मंथ ऑफ मानसून स्विंग्स वुड बी पुट अप इन द कंपाउंड एंड स्वामी जी हिमसेल्फ वुड स्विंग हिज चिल्ड्रन एंड ऑन रक्षाबंधन हिज चिल्ड्रन वुड टाई राखीज ऑन हिम. The following incident happened right here in this house. His eldest daughter Ved Kumari went to a mission school, and one day a friend of Swamiji was sitting with him. He asked little Ved Kumari to sing some song that she had learnt at school. The little child innocently joined her hands in prayer and started singing a song that rhymes something like this: "Say Jesus, Jesus, what you have to lose? Jesus is my Rama and Jesus is my Krishna." Both the friends were so crestfallen when they heard these very first lines that Swamiji removed his daughter from the mission school and decided there and then to start a school for girls. And a girls' school was started in 1891 with the help of Lala Devraj, the brother-in-law of Swamiji. Today, that small girls' school is doing a wonderful job in the field of women's education. Swamiji had a remarkable faith in God. He often received threatening letters, and one letter said that he will soon be killed on the coming day of Eid. As a result, his elder brother ordered the gates of the house shut on Eid day. At this, Swamiji got very angry and said, "Don't you have faith in God? Till he is with me, nobody can kill me." This bungalow also housed the Sadharam printing press, and later on, Swamiji donated this house to the Arya Samaj. Once Indraji, the youngest son of Swamiji, came back to Jalandhar to see his parental house in great enthusiasm. But looking at the condition of the bungalow, he could not move beyond the main gate. Even today, this is how you reach the Gurukul established by Swami Shraddhanand 100 years ago. Swamiji knew that the flame of patriotism can only be rekindled in the hearts of young Indians if their education is based on the Vedas. He felt the need of an educational institution where better citizens of India could be groomed. On November 26, 1897, the Punjab Arya Pratinidhi Sabha decided to set up a Gurukul, but the funds were a problem. Swamiji vowed in his paper Sadharam Pracharak in August 1898 that he would not set foot in his house again until he collected the required sum of money for the Gurukul, and thus he set out on his journey. People made fun of him. A Gurukul in today's times? To every doubt, Swamiji had only one answer. Only time will decide the value of the Gurukul education. And in less than a year's time, traveling far and wide, collecting donations, a determined Swamiji collected rupees 40,000 instead of the rupees 30,000 required for the Gurukul. Chaudhary Aman Singh of Najibabad was so greatly impressed by this heroic campaign of Swamiji that, not caring for the government's ire, he contributed 1,200 bighas of land and rupees 11,000 in cash to set up the Gurukul anywhere in his zamindari. Kangri village near Haridwar was exactly the kind of place Swamiji was looking for, an ideal setting for a Gurukul on the banks of the river Ganga in the foothills of the Shivaliks. Having cleared the dangerous and dense forest, the construction of temporary straw huts started under the direct supervision of Swamiji. From 21st March to 24th March 1902, during the Holi festival, the Gurukul was inaugurated. Swamiji was its first chancellor. He declared the Gurukul open to all, irrespective of their caste or creed.
दैनिक दिनचर्या वो काफी कठोर थी. सवेरे 4:30 बजे उठते थे. उस वक्त अंधेरे में ही जंगल में शौचालय जाना, फिर गंगा पर नहाना. उसके बाद संध्या हवन होता था, फिर थोड़ा प्राश प्राश करके कक्षाएँ शुरू हो जाती थी, विद्यार्थी पढ़ते थे. 4 बजे खेल होते थे. स्वामी जी का आग्रह ये था कि खेल कूद व्यायाम इसी ओर भी पूरा ध्यान दिया जाना चाहिए. क्योंकि उन्होंने घोड़े भी रखे थे कि हर विद्यार्थी घोड़सवारी सीखे.
वो बच्चों को बिल्कुल जैसे माता पिता रखते हैं ना, ऐसा रखते थे वो. हमें याद है कि हम रात को सो रहे हैं और स्वामी जी अपनी एक छोटी लेकर कर हाथ में लालटेन लेकर के रात को 9 बजे 10 बजे चक्कर लगाते थे हमारे आश्रम में. आकर के कमरों में घूम के जाते थे, देखते थे सब ठीक हैं. वो विद्यार्थियों से, ब्रह्मचारियों से आम तौर पर तू करके बात करते थे. और जब किसी को ये कह दें वो, आपने आज खाना नहीं खाया, आपको क्या तकलीफ़ है, आपने ये काम क्यों नहीं किया, ये काम ये क्यों किया, तो समझते आज तो स्वामी जी बहुत नाराज़ हैं. आज वो आप करके बोल रहे हैं ब्रह्मचारी को. तो ये उनकी एक बड़ी विशेषता थी.
The Gurukul gave Gandhiji the title of Mahatma. In 1915, when Gandhiji visited the Gurukul for the first time, the students addressed him as the Mahatma in a citation presented to him. Gandhiji often cited the example of the students of the Gurukul. When they sent him 1500 rupees for his satyagraha in South Africa, which they collected by cutting down on their milk and vegetables and by working as laborers on a dam.
और बाद में जब दोबारा उन्होंने सिविल डिसोबीडियंस मूवमेंट शुरू की 1930-31 में, तो कुछ देर के लिए गुरुकुल को तो बंद कर दिया गया था, इसलिए कि अब ब्रह्मचारी जो है भाग लेंगे बाकायदा. हम तो फर्स्ट ईयर में थे, तो हम सब रुड़की में, हरिद्वार, ये सहारनपुर में जाके हमने गांव गांव में काम किया सब ब्रह्मचारियों ने. तो और जितने वहाँ के स्नातक हैं बहुत सारे, वो सब भाग लिया, जेलों में गए ब्रह्मचारी, मैं भी जेल में गया.
जो तपस्या का जीवन हमने वहाँ पर बिता लिया, वो सारे जीवन हमारे काम आया। और यहाँ तक हुआ कि जब हमें सत्याग्रह में जेल में रहना पड़ा तो जो कठिनाइयाँ और लोगों को बहुत असह्य मालूम होती थी, हमें वो कठिनाइयाँ ही प्रतीत नहीं होती थी।
Almost every top leader of the country of that time graced the convocations of the Gurukul. To name a few, Lala Lajpat Rai, Rabindranath Tagore, Malviya Ji, Gandhi Ji. The former Prime Minister of Britain, Ramsay MacDonald, after visiting the Gurukul, wrote in his article published in the leading newspapers of England that there could not have been a more fitting reply to Macaulay's education policy in India.
Poorv Pradhan Mantri Ramsay ne bade gambhir hokar ke is baat ko kaha कि अगर कोई चित्रकार यीशु मसीह का चित्र बनाना चाहता है वर्तमान युग के अंदर, तो वो गुरुकुल कांगड़ी में जाकर के स्वामी श्रद्धानंद को देख के आए।
These premises of the Gurukul were often washed away by the floods in the Ganges. So later the Gurukul was shifted to this new location. That small lamp of Vedic education kindled by Swami Shraddhanand has now grown into a landmark institution of education. Today, it is a university imparting education in the fields of the Vedas, Ayurveda, literature, journalism, social sciences, and management. In 1917, Mahatma Munshiram took sannyas and the new name of Swami Shraddhananda. To carry his ideas to the grassroots, Swamiji foresaw the importance of the print media. On Baisakh 1 Sambat 1946, he started his first weekly named Sadharam in Urdu. He also set up the Sadharam printing press.
और मीडिया की की शक्ति को, ताकत को, उसकी पहुंच को उन्होंने पहचाना उस समय। तेज प्रेस यानी तेज अखबार तो स्वामीजी ही उसके संस्थापक थे और देशबंधु जी के साथ दोनों को संस्थापक थे।
भारत के स्वाधीनता के संघर्ष में लोकमान्य तिलक पर जब दो बार केस चला तो उसमें कंटेम्प्ट ऑफ कोर्ट का अपराध बड़ी वीरता से किया। तो उन्होंने लिखा कि ठीक है कि ब्रिटिश जुडिशरी ने, उनके कोर्ट ने लोकमान्य तिलक को दोषी ठहरा करके दंडित किया है, परंतु भारतीय जनता का हृदय रूपी न्यायालय वो लोकमान्य तिलक को आज भी निरपराधी मानता है।
Later on, Swamiji started a number of other newspapers and magazines. He created an enormous amount of literary work. Part of his work has been compiled in Shraddhanand Granthavali. He titled his autobiography Kalyan Mar Ka Pathik. The Hindi language was very dear to his heart. So he later changed the language of his writings from Urdu to Hindi. The medium of instruction at Gurukul was Hindi, and it was in Hindi that Swamiji delivered his famous speech at the Amritsar Congress.
Swamiji Maharaj ne itne sahityakar, itne patrakar paida kiye, jitne Hindi patrikarita ke pehle janak hain, wo sab Swamiji Maharaj ke shishya hain.
Swamiji was a life member of the Paropkarini Sabha. He even started writing the history of the Arya Samaj, but could not complete it due to the Dhaulpur Satyagraha and the Garhwal famine. After retiring from the Gurukul, Swamiji became active in national politics. He believed that politics must be conducted on the basic principles of Dharma. He delivered his maiden public political speech in Delhi on 7th March 1919. He drew Gandhiji's attention to the slavery of Mother India. He also gave a design of non-cooperation to Gandhiji, wherein he proposed the boycott of the English courts and non-payment of revenues by 10 districts in India. He took it upon himself to prepare 5 such districts in the Punjab and expected 5 from Gandhiji in Gujarat. To awaken the caste and sect-ridden Hindu society, he traveled throughout the country. In a landmark speech on untouchability at the Gokhale Hall in Chennai, he warned the Brahmin society to change their laws that mistreated non-Brahmins and Dalits, or else he would be forced to start a movement in which untouchables will forcibly touch Brahmins to make them untouchable too. In 1919, by signing the pledge to participate in the Satyagraha against the Rowlatt Act, he jumped into the freedom struggle of India and never looked back. Swamiji was the uncrowned king of Delhi. His popularity had crossed over the bounds of caste and religion. In 1912, Prakash, a newspaper from Lahore, did a survey on the popularity of the top political leaders. Swamiji was a close second to Lokmanya Tilak. Alongside Satyagraha demonstrations, public courts were also started in Delhi, through which Swamiji and Hakim Ajmal Khan settled disputes with great merit. And Delhi saw an unprecedented harmony between Hindus and Muslims. 30th March 1919. Swami Shradhanand was leading a procession of Satyagrahis in Delhi against the Rowlatt Act. It was a historic day in the history of India's freedom struggle. He was leading a mammoth crowd of 40,000 Satyagrahis from Company Bagh to Chandani Chowk. There were some shots fired. The crowd got restive. He instructed the crowd to maintain peace. Then he turned to the soldiers that were deployed there to ask them why the shots were fired. In a flash, many bayonets were pressed against his chest. The soldiers said, "We'll shoot you." Swamiji stood firm. Removing his robes from his chest, he dared the soldiers to shoot. This magnificent statue at the town hall bears testimony to Swamiji's unparalleled bravery and leadership abilities. Even as a politician, Swamiji kept his spiritual values intact. In his speech at the Company Bagh, he urged people to pray so strongly that the emperor, the prime minister, the India minister, all would undergo a change of heart. This Vedic chant resounded in the Jama Masjid on 4th April 1919 in the voice of Swami Shradhanand, when a meeting was organized here to pay homage to the Hindu and Muslim martyrs of the Satyagraha of 30th March. Swamiji was specially invited to grace the assembly, and he delivered a discourse from the pulpit of this mosque. He began with the Vedic chants we just heard. Swamiji was the icon of Hindu-Muslim unity. In the year 1919, following the Jallianwala Bagh massacre, Amritsar had politically become very sensitive. So the Congress Working Committee decided against holding that year's Congress session in Amritsar. But Swamiji said that such a move would demoralize the people of Punjab.
Punjab mein Congress ka naam lene ka bhi koi sahas nahi karta tha. जलियांवाला बाग में ही अत्याचार नहीं हुए थे, गुजरात में गुजरांवाला, लाहौर आदि कई नगरों में मार्शल लॉ लगाया गया था। तो उस समय जो वीर पुरुष वीरगति पा गए और जो काले पानी भेजे गए, जो जेलों में बंद ठूंस दिए गए, लंबे लंबे यातनाएं जिनको दी गई, सजाएं दी गई, उनकी पत्नियों ने और विधवाओं ने कांग्रेस कमेटी से कहा कि हमारे पतियों का स्वाभिमान और बलिदान इस बात की मांग करता है कि कांग्रेस का इस बार अधिवेशन पंजाब में ही होना चाहिए, और पंजाब में ही नहीं अमृतसर में ही होना चाहिए। तो कांग्रेस कमेटी ने कहा कि यदि स्वामी श्रद्धानंद आगे आए, वे दायित्व को स्वीकार करते हैं, तो हमें कोई आपत्ति
नहीं। Breaking all conventions, he delivered his speech in Hindi. Stressing on the need to adopt the programs of uplifting the untouchables, he said, "Let all of us sitting here sincerely take the vow that these 6.5 crore brethren, whom we call untouchables, from today are our own brothers and sisters. Their children will study with our children, and their men and women will participate with us in our struggle for freedom, shoulder to shoulder." For the Dalits, Swamiji fought not only with the Hindu society, but also with the leadership of the Congress. How many people today are aware of that fact? Swamiji had planned to buy the Jallianwala Bagh and build a memorial to the martyrs of that massacre. Swamiji was arrested for the first time while fighting alongside the Sikhs for their religious rights. Swamiji had become an eyesore for the British government, and the government was looking for any excuse to put him behind bars. On 10th September 1922, while speaking at Guru Ka Bagh in Amritsar, he assured the Sikhs of all possible help in their fight for their religious rights. He was arrested immediately after the speech was over. To annihilate his pride, Swami Shraddhananda was kept in a cage instead of a regular cell in Amritsar jail. Sikhs too paid their utmost reverence to Swamiji by inviting him to Sri Akal Takht for a discourse. Hindu society was suffering from extensive conversions. Congress had adopted an appeasement policy towards the Muslims. Hindus suffered severely during the riots of those days, but the Congress leadership was indifferent. Many top leaders like Lala Lajpat Rai, Malviya Ji and Swami Shraddhananda felt uncomfortable in the Congress and resigned.
वो एक विदेशी समस्या थी टर्की की, मुसलमान अंग्रेज़ों का तो कुछ बिगाड़ ना सके, वो जुनून उनका भड़क उठा था, वो टूट पड़े मालाबार के अंदर हिंदुओं पर।
मुस्लिम बड़े अड़ या अभ्यर्थी मस हिंदुक स्थापित
कई मंदिर तोड़े गए, देवियों से बलात्कार किया गया, लड़कियां उठा ली गईं और हजारों व्यक्तियों का संहार जो था किया गया। जो मंदिर तोड़े गए आज तक हिंदुओं ने उनको रिपेयर नहीं करवाया। उन अट्रॉसिटीज की आज भी वो याद दिलाते हैं, स्मारक हैं।
मलकानों की शुद्धि आंदोलन के बाद स्वामी सदानंद से बहुत लोग नाराज हो गए, महात्मा गांधी भी रुष्ट हो गए, लोग उनका साथ छोड़कर के जाने लगे। तो उनके एक हितेशी थे समाजसेवी लाला हरदेव सहाय, उन्होंने स्वामी जी को कहा, स्वामी जी आप क्यों इस तरह के कंट्रोवर्शियल इश्यूज हैं उनसे अपने को क्यों नहीं दूर करते, आप समाज और राष्ट्र के लिए इतना बड़ा काम कर रहे हैं। तो स्वामी जी ने तब कहा और थोड़ा गुस्से में आकर के कहा, क्या हुआ कि अगर गांधी जी मेरे से नाराज हो गए, क्या हुआ अगर सब लोग मेरा साथ छोड़ करके जा रहे हैं, क्या हुआ कि लोग मुझे धमकी भरे पत्र लिखते हैं। जब तक ईश्वर का वरद हस्त मेरी पीठ पर है, जब तक मेरे शरीर में जान है, तब तक मैं सत्य के लिए, धर्म के लिए और सच्चाई के लिए लड़ता ही रहूँगा।
लखनऊ में मौलाना अब्दुल बारी होते थे, मुसलमानों में बड़े माननीय विद्वान थे। उन्होंने एक फतवा दिया कि यदि कोई मुसलमान हिंदू हो जाता है तो वो मुर्तद है, वो वाजिबुल कत्ल है, अर्थात वो कत्ल कर देने के लायक है। और ख्वाजा सनजामी ने एक पुस्तक लिखी, उसका नाम है दाइए इस्लाम। उसमें लिखा कि मुसलमानों को जो है इस्लाम को फैलाने के लिए क्या क्या करना चाहिए। उसमें लिखा, फ़कीरों को, भिखमंगों को ऐसे इस्लाम का प्रचार करना चाहिए, गाने वालों को ऐसे प्रचार करना चाहिए, वैद्यों को, हकीमों को, जादू टूने वालों को, तवीज़ वालों को ऐसे हिंदुओं को फंसाना चाहिए। और यहाँ तक लिखा, मुसलमान जो वेश्याएँ हैं उनके पास जो हिंदू ग्राहक आए उसको अपनी जुल्फों का, अलकों का, पलकों का कैदी बनाएं और उनको भी इस्लाम की दावत दें। ये शुद्धि आंदोलन से 3 साल पहले एक किताब छपी, वो स्वामी जी के हाथ में आ गई और स्वामी जी जो थे वो चौंक पड़े। सारा हिंदू समाज जो था वो एकदम हिल गया कि ये क्या। तो स्वामी जी ने उसका नाम रखा, पुस्तक का छपवा दी, बांटी कि हिंदुओं तुम्हारे धर्म दुर्ग पर शबखून रात को घात लगाकर जो है आक्रमण किया गया है। ये बात थी। और ना ये ख्वाजा हसन निज़ामी को गांधी जी ने कुछ कहा, ना कांग्रेस के अन्य नेताओं ने,
कि कांग्रेस वालों का मुसलमानों की ओर बड़ा झुकाव था और मुसलमानों की ओर झुकाव होने के कारण वो जो है भारत में दिन प्रतिदिन हिंदुओं को मुसलमान बना रहे थे, जिस कारण वो स्वामी श्रद्धानंद जी महाराज बड़े दुखी थे। वो हिंदू महासभा में आए, फिर शुद्धि सभा की उन्होंने स्थापना की और शुद्धि सभा के द्वारा उन्होंने भारत भर में कई जगह ब्रांचें, आगरा, बरेली, बुलंदशहर जहाँ के मुसलमानों की आबादी ज़्यादा थी वहाँ पर शुद्धि का कार्य किया।
उस समय की स्थिति ये थी कि हिंदू समाज का ह्रास हो रहा था और उसको ठीक रास्ते पर लाने के लिए आर्य समाज का सबसे बड़ा योगदान था। और जब आर्य समाज ने सुधार लाने शुरू किए तो मुसलमानों में बेचैनी फैली।
To save the shrinking Hindu society from further damage, on 13th April 1923, Swami Shraddhananda established the Bhartiya Shuddhi Sabha at Agra. Thousands of those Muslims and Christians who had earlier converted to Islam or Christianity out of coercion and fear were converted back to Hinduism through Shuddhi, or the process of purification. In one of his articles in the Daily Tej, Malviyaji wrote, "There was no forcible Shuddhi of Muslims, but only of those Muslims who had converted to Islam a long time ago but continued to follow Hindu traditions. They never married into their own subcaste, and a Hindu priest would also be present in their weddings. Many even had Hindu names. They were Muslims in only a superficial way and had a desire to come back to Hinduism as they faced severe discrimination by other Muslims." The Congress session was held in Kakinada.
उस अधिवेशन के अंदर मोहम्मद अली ने इस बात के का प्रस्ताव रखा कि इस देश के अंदर 8 करोड़ अछूत या जिनको हम कहते हैं नीची जाति के लोग हैं, और ये पिछड़ी जाति के लोगों को समाप्त करने के लिए उसका एक ही तरीका है कि आधे लोग आर्य समाज हिंदू बन जाएं और आधे लोग मुसलमान बन जाएं। जब इस्लाम ने इस बात को स्वीकार नहीं किया स्वामी सिद्धानंद के कि इस देश के अंदर जो अछूत हैं उनका इस्लामीकरण रोका जाए, तो स्वामी सिद्धानंद ने शुद्धि के कार्यक्रम को प्रारंभ किया।
The influential Muslim leadership of that time impressed upon Gandhiji that the Shuddhi movement was indeed a conspiracy against Islam and must be stopped. Gandhiji asked Swamiji to stop Shuddhi immediately. Gandhiji also wrote articles in his Young India against the Arya Samaj and Swami Sadanand that encouraged Muslim fundamentalists to attack Arya Samaji leaders. The murderous attacks that started with the killing of Pandit Lekh Ram did not halt even at the murder of Mahashay Rajpal. But Swamiji went on undeterred. Shuddhi progressed at a brisk pace and thousands were converting back to Hinduism. Swamiji was declared Islam's enemy. He started receiving threats to his life. His daughter writes in her memoirs that he regularly received threatening letters that if he did not stop Shuddhi, he will be killed. And that hatred reached a pinnacle with Asghari Begum adopting Hinduism. In March 1926, a Muslim woman named Asghari Begum from Karachi approached Swamiji with the intent of getting initiated into Hinduism.
मेरी माँ का जन्म एक मुसलमान घराने में हुआ, एक मौलवी के घर। छोटी सी उम्र में जब वो 12 साल की थी, हमारे नाना ने उन्हें अरबी फारसी पढ़ा दी, कुरान शरीफ पढ़ा दिया, और उसके बाद मेरी नन्ही सी 12 साल की माँ अपने बाप से कहने लगी, बाबा जी आपने मुझे उर्दू पढ़ा दी, फारसी पढ़ा दी, कुरान शरीफ पढ़ा दिया, इस्लाम के बारे में पूरी जानकारी दे दी, अब ज़रा हिंदू रिलीजन के बारे में भी तो बता दीजिए। अब आप ही सोचिए कि उस ज़माने में 12 साल की लड़की अपने मुसलमान बाप से कहती है कि मुझे आप रामायण और महाभारत के बारे में बताइए, वेद और पुराण मुझे पढ़ने दीजिए, उपनिषदें पढ़ने दीजिए, तो ज़ाहिर है क्या हाल हुआ होगा। बहुत गुस्से में आ गए उनके बाप, लेकिन मेरी माँ की खुशकिस्मती कि उसी ज़माने में उन्हें पता चला कि स्वामी श्रद्धानंद जी जो हैं वो शुद्धि का चक्कर चला रहे हैं। वो अपने घर से निकल भागी और बहुत प्राउडली कहती थी कि मैं किसी इंसान के लिए, किसी आदमी के लिए, किसी की मोहब्बत में, दौलत की लालच में नहीं भागी, बल्कि अपना नॉलेज बढ़ाने के लिए, हिंदू रिलीजन पढ़ने के लिए, अरबी अगर मैंने पढ़ी थी तो मैं संस्कृत क्यों ना पढूं, ये इच्छा लेकर वो स्वामी जी के शरण में आ गई।
Accordingly, she was initiated into Hinduism and renamed as Shanti Devi.
लेकिन दुनिया वालों को चैन कहाँ आता है, लोग इस दौरान में दूसरी तरफ से आते रहे और ये फरमाइश करते रहे कि हमारी बच्ची हमें वापस करो, असगरी बेगम को शांति देवी आपने कैसे बना दिया।
Her father, Maulvi Taj Muhammad, and her husband approached Swamiji and insisted that Asghari Begum go back with them.
लेकिन स्वामीजी की मोहब्बत देखिए मेरी माता के प्रति कि उन्होंने कहा कि शांति को मैंने अपनी धर्मपुत्री बनाया है, वो मेरी बेटी है और मैं चाहूँगा कि जहाँ वो खुश रहती है वहीं वो रहे, जबरदस्ती आप उसको नहीं ले जा सकते मेरे जीते जी।
But Shanti Devi was not ready to convert back to Islam. Matters worsened. Criminal suits were filed against Indraji, Swamiji and Dr. Sukhdev, charging them with the abduction and forcible conversion of Asghari Begum. In November 1926, Swamiji went to Varanasi but fell ill and returned back to Delhi. On December 4, 1926, The court dismissed the case and Swamiji and the others were honorably acquitted. The Arya Samaj breathed a sigh of relief. But fundamentalist Muslims had something different in their minds. They started propaganda against Swamiji, and the writings of Hasan Nizami added fuel to the fire. It seems that Swamiji had a premonition of his death. His son Indraji wrote, "On 22nd December 1926, Swamiji sent for me, Dr. Sukhdev and Lala Deshbandhu Gupt, and insisted on writing his will." Swamiji was suffering from pneumonia, and his body had become very weak. On 23rd December, a few hours before his martyrdom, Swamiji sent a reply to a wire from Sir Raja Ram Singh saying, "Now I wish to leave this worn-out body to adopt another one and finish the incomplete works of this life." December 23rd, 1926, that fateful day. His residence at Naya Bazaar, now known as Swami Shradanand Balidan Bhavan. His room on the first floor, about 4 o'clock in the late afternoon. Swamiji was taking rest while his attendant Dharam Singh was sitting just outside the closed doors. Dharam Singh heard some approaching footsteps on the staircase.
एक आदमी ऊपर आया और उसने कहा कि मुझे स्वामी शरदानंद से मिलने का है। तो उन्होंने कहा वो बीमार हैं, उनसे आप नहीं मिल सकते। तो अंदर से स्वामी जी ने आवाज़ दी कि अरे भाई कौन है, आने दो ना, क्या बात है, क्यों नहीं। कहने लगा जी ये आपसे मिलना चाहते हैं, आपको तो डॉक्टर ने मना किया है। तो उसने कहा कि नहीं आने दो।
Dharam Singh took the man whose name was Abdul Rashid to Swamiji. When Swamiji asked Abdul Rashid the purpose of his visit, he replied that he wanted to discuss something related to Islam. Swamiji asked him to come some other time as he was indisposed.
और उसने पानी मांगा। नाना जी ने अपने साथी को कहा जरा पानी लेके आना अंदर से। वो पानी लेने गया और नाना जी ने आंखें बंद की, उनको मालूम था। सीधी उसने गोली तानी और सीधी तीन शॉट एक के बाद एक।
Dharam Singh came running. Swamiji's secretary Dharampal also came rushing over. Both of them overpowered the killer by risking their own lives, but they could not save Swamiji. Swamiji left for his heavenly abode. He had probably foreseen his end that morning itself. On 25th December 1926, the last rites of Swamiji's mortal remains were performed. Crowds of his followers surged from every nook and corner of the country to have a last glimpse of their dear Swamiji.
अपनी तीसरी मंजिल से देखा मैंने, तो इतना कि सारा बाजार जो है, वो सड़क जो है, वो भरी हुई है सफेद कपड़ों से और लोग जो हैं वो नारे लगा रहे हैं।
Such a huge funeral procession had no precedence in Delhi's history. Over 4 lakh people participated in it. But a certain group of Muslims took more than keen interest in the trial of Abdul Rashid, the murderer of Swami Shradanand, who had worked for Hindu-Muslim unity all his life. The murderer was called Ghazi, but still, the Arya Samaj never blamed the entire Muslim community for this act. In fact, Indraji, the son of Swamiji, was ready to even appeal to the government for Abdul Rashid's pardon. Rich tributes were paid to Swamiji. Condolences poured in from far and near. In his condolence message, Gandhiji said, "He lived a hero, he died a hero. He was bravery personified." Gandhiji was so hurt by this cowardly act of Swamiji's assassination that he condemned it in his paper Hindi Navjeevan in these incredible words. He wrote, Muslims will have to undergo an acid test. There is no doubt that their hands are too skilled in wielding daggers and guns. Their swords still keep coming out of their sheaths too often. If Islam has to become Islam, that means peace, then it has to confine its swords to their sheaths. In his autobiography, Nehru wrote, "The end of that year, 1926, was darkened by a great tragedy which sent a thrill of horror all over India. Swami Shraddhanand was assassinated by a fanatic as he lay in his bed. What a death for a man who bared his chest to the bayonets of the Gurkhas and marched to meet their fire. Nearly 8 years earlier, he, an Arya Samaji leader, had stood in the pulpit of the great Jama Masjid of Delhi and preached to a mighty gathering of Muslims and Hindus of unity and India's freedom. And that great multitude had greeted him with loud cries of Hindu Musulman ki jai, long live Hindus and Muslims. His tall and stately figure wrapped in a sannyasi's robe, eyes flashing. How I remember that vivid picture and how often it comes back to me."
Om Dyau Shanti.
Each bullet lodged in Swamiji's chest is crying out in the words of martyr Bismil, asking, "The assassin is calling out again and again. Is there anyone here with a wish to die?"
Shantir Vishve Devaha, Shantir Brahma, Shanti Sarvam, Shanti Shanti Reva, Shanti Sama, Shanti Om Shanti Shanti.